Our congregation in Thousand Oaks loves Pastor Joe, and actually our congregation and this congregation have something in common, that when I'm finished speaking, you're both going to want Pastor Joe back. So he's a treasure. One of the things, years ago, I was invited to West Texas to speak in some public schools, and I've spoken in over 200 public schools in California. And when you speak in California, you're not allowed to use God, Bible, Jesus. And I came to the West Texas schools, and I said, you know, I'm not allowed to talk about Jesus or the Bible. And the superintendent of one of the smaller school districts in West Texas said, son, you're in Texas. You go ahead and talk about anything you want. So. I was born in California in 64. And before I get to that, I wanted to tell you this much. It's true, I am a politician and a pastor. So my mom used to say, God rest her soul, she used to say, you never talk about religion and politics in mixed company. So I'm the guy you don't invite to dinner. Now, this is difficult for Christendom, because you, last 50 years in America, you have all been inculcated and indoctrinated that there's a separation of church and state. And you're looking at me like, I'm not sure I buy this. And fair enough. I wasn't sure I was buying it myself in 2014, because I didn't believe that there was a mix there. But I'm in California. I've been there since my birth. And I'm part of a series of churches. This is C3, but I'm part of a series of churches called Calvary Chapel. Calvary Chapel started in California in 1968. A guy by the name of Chuck Smith broke away from the Four Square Churches, and he and his wife Kay, in California in 68, it was interesting. We had Reagan as governor. Ronald Reagan was our governor of the state in 68. And we had the fifth largest GDP, gross domestic production. It was the state of the future. Our secondary school systems, Stanford, Berkeley, USC, UCLA, everybody wanted to go to our secondary school systems, the schools of higher learning. And it was the place to be. The space industry was there, high desert, we dominated. We had marvels of engineering. We had created the California Aqueduct, which brought water from the Sierras into the most fertile farmland in the world in the San Joaquin Valley. And we produced more cotton in the San Joaquin Valley than the entire South combined. But in 68, there was a problem across the country, not unlike 2019, 2020. The nation was divided. It was in turmoil. You see, in 63, John F. Kennedy had been shot here in Dallas. And in 1968, when Chuck pulls away from the Four Square Churches, he looks out at a sea of broken lives, young people. And it was the hippie movement. And the shores of California were awash with these young people who had checked out of the church and bought into Eastern religions and drug use. And all of California was awash, Haight-Ashbury all the way down to Southern California, hippies as far as the eye could see, burned out folks. And in 68, one of the reasons why is they lost John F. Kennedy in 63, and then in 68, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was shot on a balcony in Memphis, Tennessee. And then Bobby Kennedy Jr. was shot in Los Angeles. And all their heroes of hope and change had been killed. And then we had the Vietnam War and the Tet Offensive, and we were losing our young people in a war in a nation we didn't know very much about. And there were war riots, and my father was a Navy captain, three tours of Vietnam. I remember in San Diego going through Lindbergh Field as a young boy. He had returned from Vietnam, and the people there spit on him. I didn't understand all that. I remember when we were in Washington, D.C. at the Navy Yard, and we'd go out to the Washington Monument, and there was protesters. And it was frightening. And the nation was in turmoil, and there was a pull for socialism and communism, and there was this idea of capitalism and American and America, and the church was struggling. And Chuck Smith looks out at California awash with these disenfranchised, just burned out people. And he says, I'm going to go back and keep the main thing the plain thing, and the plain thing the main thing. And he begins to teach the simplicity of the scriptures, verse by verse, chapter by chapter, book by book. And he brings in this worship style called Maranatha music, where they allow syncopated rhythms. You saw Victor in the aquarium over here. Syncopated rhythms. And these syncopated rhythms and bringing in this kind of new music, it revolutionized a church. And Calvary Chapel Costa Mesa was one of the first megachurches in the world. And he and Kay just started reaching out to him. And they'd come in, you know, smelling like the north end of a southbound donkey, barefooted, just ragtag. And yet the church started to explode, and these folks were getting back to the Word. And Calvary Chapel, through that model in 1968, he was deliberate to avoid politics. He was deliberate to avoid politics. He didn't want to do that because he knew that he'd lose these young people. And so he just stayed to the Word. And what happened is Calvary Chapel had a 10,000% growth since 1968. Here we are in 2020. He had 10,000% growth. There's 1,800 Calvary Chapels around the world since 1968. In California, Southern California, from Van Nuys, if you know where that is, it's near L.A., south to San Diego, there's over 350 Calvary Chapels. Two of the 10 largest churches in America, Calvary Chapels. If you've ever heard of the Harvest Crusades of Greg Laurie, Calvary Chapels. And that's conversion growth, not transfer growth. These are people who just came to Christ, raising their hand, whole lives being transformed. And it's amazing. And that was 1968, and you see how God has done this, and it's California is inundated, and we have some of the most beautiful buildings, Bible colleges, we have crusades, we have Christian concerts, we have bookstores, we have inundated the state of California. And then here we are today. Where's the power of the gospel? Because the gospel, the Bible says, go into all the nations and make disciples of all nations. And we look at where's the power of the gospel? And you say, what do you mean, Pastor? Well, here we are in 2020, and let's see what 10,000% growth of churches in California have done for us while staying out of the public square. We no longer have the fifth largest GDP in California. We have the sixth, maybe seventh. We have the highest gas tax, sales tax, income tax, corporate tax. We lead the nation in debt. You combine the next four largest states, their debt, it doesn't equal the debt of California. We're the authors of no-fault divorce that Reagan signed into law in 1970 that decimated marriage across the country. Transgender bathroom bills. Our new sex ed curriculum, you can't show it in church. We lead the nation in poverty. We lead the nation in homelessness. Our roads are terrible. You got to wear a kidney belt anywhere you go. Here's the kicker. We lead the nation in abortion. We've aborted more children than the entire nation of Canada, the population. So the question is, where's the power of the gospel? And you say, well, that's not a big deal. Well, I just want to tell you something. More people have left the state of California than came there during the Dust Bowl. And 86% of all Californians that have left the state as it's imploding and you can't survive there, millennials are leaving, 86% of the people that have left California have come right here to Texas. Yes. Don't worry, I'm not coming. Right now. But that's the reality. They're coming here. And why? Why are they leaving? Tom McClintock, who's a congressman, said, what would cause someone, and if you've ever been to California, you know what I mean. On a good California day, you can be surfing in the Pacific Ocean, snow skiing in the Sierras, and dirt bike riding in the desert all in one day. It's magical. It's beautiful. We have the California redwoods, coastal scenes that'll just blow you away. And Tom McClintock said, what can cause someone to leave the beauty of California for the deserts of Nevada and Texas? I mean, you got humidity here. There's no bugs. No bugs in California. No humidity. We have the greatest microclimate on the face here. 78 degrees all year round. No humidity. You can come visit. It's expensive, but you can come visit. Why would they leave? Because there's opportunity here. And I share all that with you because as Pastor Joe passed these things out, and a lot of you went, nah, okay, voter registration. Where does that come from? You see, government is something God gave us in the Noahic covenant in Genesis. He gave it to us. Why? Because how do we live together? Aristotle said politics is the highest form of community because it includes morality and sociability. How do we get along with one another? How do we do business? How do we do a transaction? How do we live next door to each other? How do we agree what we're going to teach in schools? How do we agree how we're going to operate our traffic lights and our signals? How do we do that? What are considered just laws and what are considered unjust laws? Where does that come from? Is it just happenstance? Does God speak into that? Of course he does. Well, I don't see I don't see government in the Bible. Then you haven't read it. The reality is, if politics is the highest form of community because it combines morality and sociability, then what is the best form of government? And what I'm finding now, which is interesting to me, and this is inundated in California, because if the church doesn't drive the culture, it adapts to it. And that's what's happened in California. we're watching as they're indoctrinating our children and they're taking care of all these things and they're making taxes so high we can't live there. And the church is just whittling why it's happening, and we're happy and we're getting smaller and smaller. And they're taking away our rights and they're telling us what, you know, you can't need that and all this stuff. You have a lot of freedom here in California, but you're only 10 years ahead of us. It's catching up. I've been in that state my whole life. I've watched it. I remember when it was like this. And so here's the picture. If we look at our lives and we say, okay, how do we operate in this capacity? God is saying we need to wake up to our responsibility. People say, you know, there's a separation church and state. I go, where is that located in the Founding Fathers documents? I've read all of them. I've read the first 10 years of the congressional record. It doesn't exist. Oh, you're talking about the letter of Jefferson to the Baptist or to the Danbury Baptist Convention? And they use that as a separation church and state. It's the exact opposite. It's keep the state out of the church, not the church out of the state. You just go ahead and read it. But you look at our representative form of government, and this is what's being taught in pulpits across America. They're saying that socialism is a Christian ideal. Now, okay, I get it, because you know, we want to have equal. I get that. And I get why young people love socialism, because it makes sense in theory. But here's the problem. What's your name? I'm sorry, Adam? Are you Eve? No, I'm sorry. Lauren. Adam and Lauren. Adam, you're getting an A in class. You're both in the same class. You're getting an A, and you're working your tail off, and you're doing your homework, and you're staying up late burning the candle and midnight oil, and you're doing your work. And Lauren, you're not. You're sleeping in. You're partying too much. You're getting an F. Adam's getting an A. Now, this is socialism. I want to make you equal. Equal in outcome. So I'm going to take two grades from you, and I'm going to give them to Lauren. So Adam, you have a C, and Lauren, you have a C, so we're equal. Now here's what's going to happen. When it comes time for the next semester, you're not going to work as hard, because what's the point? And you're going to wait for your handout, so productivity is going to decrease. So you take the fourth greatest nation on the face in the Western Hemisphere, which is Venezuela, fourth greatest nation, and you give it socialism, and within a handful of years, they're eating their zoo animals. Because productivity dissipates. That's socialism. It's real simple. And you say, well, no, it's equal outcome. Well, the Bible says that we're to love one another and we've been created equal in that sense, but not in capacity, but in dignity. Not in capacity, but in dignity. Because a lot of you are smarter than I am. So in capacity, you are smarter than I am, but in dignity, we're equal. And how do we dwell with one another? Some of you are better at some things than I am. How do we work that? And if you think, well, capitalism's not in the Bible, yes, it is. Every issue of government is in the scriptures, but we have to go deeper. We have to study. And I want to share with you this, and then I'll close it up, because I know Pastor Joe said I have 45 minutes, and I'm going to make sure I do that all. I'll begin with this one, and this is a verse out of Genesis. And this is what was precious to me, because we were singing about, you know, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. I was moved. That song touched me because we're saved by grace, and it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And here, Abraham believed God, and it was accredited to him as righteousness. And this is in Genesis. Genesis is the beginning. Abraham believed God, it was accredited to him as righteousness. And as we were singing that song, it took me back to November 6th, 2018. You see, it was a Tuesday, and I was trying to get some folks elected. It was an election day, and everything I voted for lost. I was up all night waiting for the election returns. I had been counseling people and comforting them, walking them through the election process, and they'd been beat up, and it was awful. And you don't know California politics. It's terrible. And so Wednesday night, on November 8th, 2018, they all came to church. And we were undone. We were broken. And it almost seemed as though there was no hope. And I talked on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that God wants to give that to you, and how much more will our Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? And it's a gift. It's a grace gift. You ask Him. And I said, just put your hands out and say, Lord, fill me. In those times you don't know what to do, God, fill me. And then we sang that song, and it was almost as though everything I'd worked for in that election just lifted, and I had a peace that surpassed all understanding. And I was tired that night. I'd been up all Tuesday night. I was tired. Wednesday night, I went home, put my head on the pillow. And 11 o'clock that night, 11:30 that night, there's a knock on my sliding glass door by my bed, which no one ever knocked. And I open it up, my daughter, and she says, Dad, and at the time I was mayor pro tem and soon to be mayor of the city, and she says, Dad, there's been a shooting down at the borderline. borderline's a dance hall where people would go to do country western. Our young people would go there. It was almost like a youth room. And a homegrown gunman actually lived three blocks away from my house I'd lived in for over 15 years. He walked in and unleashed on the dance floor, killed 12 of our young people. Every one of them was a Christian involved in their church, and four of them were Eagle Scouts. He killed them. Then he took the gun to himself. He'd actually shot on Sergeant Helis, one of our officers, who ended up dying. And I remember I got up and I went to the command center, and all the people were there. And these kids, over 300 of them, it was college night, they'd broken the windows and rabbited out, and they were coming bleeding from the glass shards, and they were showing up, and paramedics were working on it. Parents were waiting to hear if their kids were okay. And I remember just being so overwhelmed. I said, Lord, would you fill me? Would you help me, God? He did. I turned around at 2 o'clock that morning, went to the Alex Fiore Teen Center where the parents who had not found out where their kids were, they called the hospitals to see if they checked in. They knew something was wrong, and the ones that ended up at the teen center knew that there was something terrible that was coming down the pike. I stayed with them till the morning. About 1 o'clock the next day, the inevitable came. I was with 8 of the 12 families as they were told that their child was one of the victims. We had a vigil that night. City mourned. And after it was all over, I drove home only to have been evacuated from my house because the fires had burned around our city. Hell visited us that day. I went to every one of the 12 memorials. I officiated 2 of them. Because 2 of our congregants were killed. Dan Manrique, a Marine veteran, 3 tours. He worked with our special needs kids. He was going back in when they shot him. Blake Dingman, his grandparents sit right there. His parents sit right there every Sunday. And there's a seat missing next to him. We ministered to that community. I became mayor. We dedicated a park on November 8th, 2019 to the victims, had a chance to minister to all of them. Many have come to Christ. The council members have all been touched by it. I didn't realize that when I ran for office, but I know this much. What is the purpose of government? Because as you look, the very first book of the Bible, we're only 15 chapters in, and God says to Abraham, you believe me, and I'm going to give you, you're saved. You're saved. And how are you saved? It's real simple in the scriptures, because when you look where it says he believed God has accredited him as righteousness, in this passage in Ephesians, it says, for by grace you've been saved through faith. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. If you believe in your heart and you confess with your tongue, Jesus is Lord, you will be saved to the glory of the Father. So Abraham understood it, you understand it, and we're good. We're saved by grace. We got our get out of hell free card. Amen? Yeah. Seriously, you don't have to, we're saved by grace. He did all the work. I was listening to the worship team. That one song blew me away. This idea that he bled on that cross and he died for sins he did not commit. And you see the heaviness of those words and it touches you. We were on death row and he came along to die in our place. I can't die for you on death row because I got my own penalty and you got yours to die for. But he is sinless and he died in all of our places. And you receive that by faith. It's a gift. Abraham had the same thing. So here's the problem. Why did he give the law? The law doesn't come until 430 years later. If you see here, the promise granted through faith, for the promise that would be the heir of the world, not to Abraham or his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. They were saved by grace through faith, but then God gives this law. And the law can't save you. It couldn't do through the flesh what the Spirit has done. So he gives this law 430 years later in Exodus and Leviticus and Deuteronomy, and he lays it out, and you're looking at that going, wait a minute, we're saved by grace. Abraham was saved. God, why did you give a law? Thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Why did you give a law? I mean, we already had salvation. You know, people in the Old Testament look forward to the point in time when Christ would be crucified for that sacrifice, and they believed by faith, and they believed God, it was accredited to them as righteousness. We look back to a point in time, and we're saved by grace through faith, and it all works. But here in this passage, what's fascinating to me is that God gives the law. And as I look at this, I think to myself, why did he give the law? And he gives the law, I can't see this, but I'll work through it. I'll hit the button because that's how they taught me to do it. So Abraham is saved by grace through faith. Genesis 15, 430 years later, why did God give the law? Why did he do that if the law doesn't save? Here's what's interesting. 3 to 5 million Jews, have you ever read the story? 3 to 5 million Jews leave Egypt. Do you remember this? It's the longest running family meal in world history. It's called the Passover. You remember that? Jews still celebrate all over the world. Churches do it. We do the Passover. And why did they leave Egypt? Because they were in bondage. What's bondage? Slavery. What is slavery? Slavery, freedom is having choices. If you get $100 in your paycheck, if you get $100 in your paycheck and you go to a restaurant where everything on the menu is $100 or less, you have complete freedom to buy anything you want on that menu. But along comes the government, takes 25%, you have 25% less choices, thus you have 25% less freedom. And if you go to California, they take 50% of it. You have 50% less choices, 50% less freedom. You go to Venezuela, and just, they own it all. And after a while, you're known as what's called a slave. You work all day for someone else. And all these Jews were crying out to God, saying, in the soul of every human heart is a cry for freedom, liberty. You'll know the truth will set you free. And they're crying out to God, we're laboring all day and we have slaves over us. In 6,000 years of recorded history, every government on the face of the earth has been an oligarchy where the elite rule the many, the few rule the many. And they're crying out to God, help us. And Pharaoh's got his boot on their neck. And God, by these 10 plagues, delivers 3 to 5 million Jews. And they get to come out of slavery. And as they're marching, God does a miracle. And in this miracle, he parts the Red Sea. He parts the Red Sea. And then, this is what's crazy. As they part the Red Sea, this miracle, and I think I just pressed the button correctly, God gives the law. Moses goes up on Mount Sinai. And God gives him a downloaded moral app. In this downloaded moral app, first 5 commandments are relationship with God. Second 5 commandments are relationship with each other. Now, the 5th commandment is kind of in between. It's part of the first 5 and it's part of the last 6. Because it's honor thy mother and father, it'll go well with you, you'll live long on the earth. Not only honor your parents, which is the beginning of all culture, but it's also honor your God, honor your father in heaven. So it's a very critical component to both. It's a segue, how we raise godly families. And so he receives this downloaded moral app. He comes down from Mount Sinai. They're already partying. They got a golden calf, and they're doing bad things. And he takes this law, and he lays it out, and then he follows the precepts of the Lord, and they set up this temple where God becomes the center of their culture and their community. And as they lay all this out, here's what's fascinating. Walk with me through this. You have all of these things, these miracles. You had the 10 plagues, the parting of the Red Sea, manna. They would come out in the wilderness. They were in the wilderness for 40 years when they crossed through the Red Sea and God vanquished the Pharaoh's army in the Red Sea. Remember that? Pharaoh did the dead man's float. And they get into the wilderness, which is a generous way of saying desert. And it's desert. And every morning they'd wake up, there'd be manna on the ground. They'd have bamama bread. They'd have bamanicotti, or I don't know, they'd have all this stuff. Manna, every morning. And then they say, well, we're tired of manna. And so God blew quail off course, and they showed up. And they had so much quail meat, it was coming out their nostrils. Serious, read it. And here's the other one, water where there wasn't any. In the wilderness, water would be pouring, gushing. 3 to 5 million Jews are being cared for 40 years where there's nothing. That's like 40, you talk to the to anyone who does logistics to try to feed a military, feeding 3 to 5 million people is trainloads and trainloads of supplies. And here's the kicker. The scriptures say their clothes never wore out, their shoes never wore out for 40 years. Miracle after miracle after miracle. But that's not the greatest miracle. This is the one that gets me. What was the greatest miracle of all? And you're wondering, what's the point of government? What's the point of the law? Well, here's the greatest miracle of all. The law made it possible for 3 to 5 million Jews to live at peace with each other without a police force or a standing army. Well, cut my legs off and call me Shorty. Why? Because we're accountable to God and we're accountable to each other. You say, what's so big about that, Pastor? In 6,000 years of recorded history, in a little span of time for 244 years, and by the way, we're a nation that has lived under one birth certificate longer than any other nation in the history of the world. And that birth certificate says, when in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve their union. And it goes on further to say, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, endowed by their Creator. Four times in the Declaration of Independence, God is listed, endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, meaning you can't take them away, you can't give them away, among those being life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And you go, happiness? We don't even know what happiness is anymore, but everyone educated in the First Great Awakening and went through civic responsibility, they studied Aristotle, they knew what happiness meant. We've lost that in the last 50 years. Life. You can't have liberty and happiness without life, and we are all about life. Sanctity of Life Sunday. First time in the history of our country the president shows up. Oh, the church has kind of walked away from the abortion issue because it's just not popular, and we're adapting to culture. We're not changing it. So now we're doing other things that are more hip. I stand for life in my church. And it's not popular in California. And I'm outspoken. And you know what happened in our city? Somebody burned the Planned Parenthood. Caused the fire alarms to go off. And because I'm outspoken, they blame me and this lady who is an activist in our community, wrote a letter to the editor and blamed me for my rhetoric that I was responsible for the burning of that. The FBI came out, and the paper actually ran it. No, she didn't know anything about me. They came in to find out later it was a disgruntled employee who had done it. Never retracted the story. But what's interesting is God told me a long time ago, people aren't the enemy, they're the opportunity. I didn't dislike this woman. I loved her. I prayed for her. And one night, and she's a secular progressive. She's not a Christian. She's not a church-going lady. You can find her at a certain restaurant where she drinks a lot. Now, and I don't say that to dismiss her. I'm saying she's hurting. And one night we had, because we're called Thousand Oaks, we have the strictest tree laws in the nation. And we were having a discussion. We were having a city council meeting on tree ordinances, a six-hour meeting on the circumference of oak trees. It's like, just, I can't. And I'm sitting in a six-hour meeting on the circumference of oak trees, and we're going on and on and on. And it's driving me crazy. And I'd brought some snacks, because you can see this is body by snacks. And I've got some chocolate-covered almonds, and I notice that we finally take a break because we're all exhausted, and I see them over there, and they are advocates for oak trees. They're bringing in little potted plants. These are their children, and they're so thrilled about it. And I go over, and I give them some of the almonds, and they're like, thank you, and I'm making friends with them, and here's the lady. And God had told me to do this, and I reach in my pocket, and I pull out, this is the exact one, I pull out this little acorn. I go, look what I got. And she goes, oh, that's a California coastal oak, and she uses the Latin genus on it, and she says it, and I'm like, wow. I said, I found this today, and it just kind of helped me with the decisions I'm going to make today. She says, well, thank you. You've really been... I said, yeah. I said, I have a question for you, though. If I put this in soil, put water and sunlight, will it turn into a palm tree? She says, no, stupid. It can only be an oak tree. I said, a baby in the womb can only be a baby, a human being. As much as you love these, I love that baby in the womb. She says, you have a compelling argument there for another time. I said, do you promise me? She says, yes, Rob. Politics is done by addition and multiplication, not by division and subtraction. And you have to love folks, but you have to know what it is you stand for. And people aren't the enemy, they're the opportunity. And God gave us this so we can live together. He gave us this law so that we could dwell together. And good government only happens with good people. And when you abdicate your responsibility because you say, government is dirty, this is my favorite one. I hear this, 20,000 pastors I've spoken to across the country, politics is dirty. You know what my response is? So is the church. What's your point? This is my favorite. I'm tired of voting for the lesser of two evils. I always say, well, unless Jesus Christ is running for office, you're always voting for the lesser of two evils. Here's my favorite. Listen, I am as candid as possible. I could care less how you feel about the President of the United States, whether you like him or hate him. Welcome to church. Seriously, this is not going to divide us, but I am going to be candid about this. He's the last guy I thought about voting for. I'm going to tell you the truth. I had everybody else in mind, and when he came along, I'm like, nah, I don't know. He's been 3 times married, 2x divorced. He slept with every woman in New York by his own admission. The guy is just crazy, his tweets, and oh my goodness, and I'm a pastor, and I'm like, I can't, And then one day I was reading out of Judges 14, and I started reading about Samson. And I saw in Hebrews 11 that Samson is in the hall of faith. God put Samson in the hall of faith. I can't teach Judges 14 in a Sunday school. Samson, he's in the hall of faith in the New Testament. And you read about his life, he's raised in what would be the equivalent of a homeschool family. And when he comes of age, the very first words out of his mouth are, you know what, mom and dad, I want nothing to do with Christianity. I want to go marry that pagan woman down the Philistine territory. Go get her. He's selfish, self-serving. He's just self-consumed. And the guy is a partier. He just breaks away from everything his parents instilled in him, and he goes down to the Philistines. And the scripture says he was in a prostitute's bed all night, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. Really, how do you teach that in Sunday school? And not just once, but twice in a prostitute's bed all night, and the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him. The scripture says he went down to go pay off a gambling debt, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. You can't name one moral thing about Samson's life. Not one. It's awful. They gouge his eyes out, and the only thing he can do is get revenge on the Philistines to pull the temple down. They've cut his hair off, and that's the thing about him. He had iconic hair, and his downfall was women, which made me think of Trump. Why would God pick a guy like that? And you're wondering if I'm saying the president, I'm talking about Samson. Why would God pick a guy like that? Judges 14:4. What Samson's parents didn't realize, Manoah and his wife, what Samson's parents didn't realize is God was seeking an occasion to move against the Philistines. Samson was willing to do what God's people weren't. The Philistines were occupying territory that rightfully belonged to God. Do our schools belong to God? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness therein. Does the government belong to God? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Yes? But the government will be upon his shoulders. I'm not talking about dominionism. I'm not talking about theocracy. I'm talking about the influence of the law that God gave 430 years after grace so that we could live together without a standing police force and an army. That we could dwell together and know that you don't steal from each other. That socialism is a violation of thou shalt not covet and thou shalt not steal. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. Figure it out. And here you have Samson. He's the last guy you would ever think of. Now, I don't care how you feel about the president, but why would God pick? Because the Bible says God appoints all positions of authority. Why would you pick this guy? Why would you pick him? There's 7 mountains of cultural influence in the world. There's arts and entertainment, media, politics, religion, business, family, and education. And each of those mountains of cultural influence has a currency. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, you're the salt of the earth. The salt loses its flavor. It's thrown out, trampled underfoot, good for nothing. Anyone hearing that sermon would understand in Latin, all the Roman soldiers, is Saul in Latin is salt. And where you get the word salary, worth your weight in salt, Romans were paid in salt. And what Jesus was saying is, if you don't know the currency, we're going to trample you, and you're good for nothing. And here's the interesting thing. What is the currency in these 7 mountains of cultural influence? I'll tell you what. In politics, it's winning elections. If you can't hang scalps on the wall, and I say that jokingly, if you can't win an election, you're irrelevant. Now, I'm saying that as a pastor who's also a politician. If someone says to me, I can't vote for a man who's been 3 times married and 2x divorced, it's just immoral, I'm going to vote for a third-party candidate. I look at you and I go, okay, that's moral pietism, and I just want you to know, good for you, and you made your gesture, but you're irrelevant in the political process. April 14th, 1865, the great emancipator Abraham Lincoln got a bullet to the back of his head by John Wilkes Booth. He died on April 15th, 1865, and it was Good Friday. And if you study Stephen Mansfield and the curator of the Lincoln Library to see what all of the pulpits, the title of the sermons were on that Good Friday, they decried the fact that Abraham Lincoln died in a theater on Good Friday. That's moral pietism. No one has quoted scripture or been more consumed with the gospel than Abraham Lincoln. Elizabeth Keckley, who was his assistant or his aide, said that that man loved the Lord. If you look at his Bible, Job is dog-eared. Every quote, you look at his first inaugural and second inaugural address, it's inundated with scripture. And pulpits decried the fact he died in a theater on Good Friday. That's moral pietism. You see, as ministers, we feel better because we can decry the immorality of whoever it is who's running for office, that somehow we're better than they are. You look at these cultural mountains of influence, each having a currency. Arts and entertainment. Movie tickets. You got to sell tickets, right? You got to have a popular show. I don't care if you like him or you don't like him. I'm showing you why maybe God picked him. The president, he had the number one television show in America, for what that's worth. Media, what's the currency of media? How many followers you have? He won the election with a Twitter account. The guy stays up all night. I think he did 70 tweets in like 4 hours. That's all he... Politics, cultural amount of influence politics. He beat 17 Republican candidates and the most heavily funded Democratic candidate in the history of our nation. Family. 3 times married, 2 times divorced. Gets along with his ex-wives and all of his kids are successful in their own right, however you feel about them. And you just go down the list on all these things. Business. The Trump brand is world-renowned. What I'm saying is, like Samson, you don't have to like him. God picked him. Now, let's look at it in this regard. Why did he pick him? Because we're not doing anything. There's 60 to 80 million evangelical Christians in America. Half are not registered to vote. Half of those don't vote. And in a non-presidential election, it's 12%. And so God sends this guy from New York, and you're like, well, you know, I like the fact that he's given us religious liberty, and I like the fact that he's not enforcing the Johnson Amendment, and I like the fact that he's pro-life, and he's the first one to ever speak on it, and make in a major presidential debate to stand for the unborn, and he stopped child trafficking, and I like all those things. And I like it's the lowest black unemployment, lowest Hispanic unemployment, lowest women unemployment. I like all those things. But we didn't lift a finger to do it. And now it comes time to be able to engage. And where do we get a representative form of government? How much time do I have left? Because I'm getting on a war. Okay. Where was I? I was just thinking right there, and then got that one, and it's just, which one did I press? Okay, there we are. Okay, look at this. This is exciting, because I have no idea what it is. This is out of Exodus, and it says, and Jethro says to Moses, and this is where we get a representative form of government. Jethro says to Moses, as there's 3 to 5 million Jews, and they're like, how do we live together? And Jethro goes to Moses, and he says, you're going to select people, able men such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness, and place such men to be rulers over thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Got it? Because you're wondering where this government came from. Our founders read that passage, and here it is. Look at that. That's so cool. It's just technology, and it doesn't work. Boom. This is Isaiah 33:22. I love this. For the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. You're like, oh, what's the point of that? You'll see. I set you up. 3 branches of government, executive, king, legislative, lawgiver, judicial, judge. Isaiah 33:22 came from our founders. That's how they got the 3 branches of government. If you want to know what federal government, state, local, or county and local, appoint godly men, able men who are not covetous, appoint them over thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Federal, state, county, local. Representative. You guys don't seem impressed. Now, Galatians. For those of you going, well, that's Old Testament. That doesn't pertain to us. And okay, time out. Let's go to the New Testament. This is one of my favorite passages in Galatians. And the idea is it says that the law is a school teacher. The point is to Christ. And it keeps us protected until faith comes. You see, the church for the last 50 years has said, oh, the law is a school, Marm. And racks your knuckles. The law is only there to show you can't keep it and you need to be saved by grace through faith. No, 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 no. That's not what Paul says. Paul says the law is to be placed in society so that the laws of nature and nature's God, and it doesn't matter if you're a Christian or an atheist, you're bound by the laws of gravity, the laws of nature and nature's God. apply them in such principles that people see them. That a baby is to be safe in a mother's womb. That you don't traffic another human being. That ideologies and compacts are important, and covenants that you make with your people deserve a border. You know, I live in California. I have to lock my gate because the house we bought has this rickety old jacuzzi. And if the child next door comes into my house when I'm away on vacation and climbs into the jacuzzi, I am liable because I entice that child into that jacuzzi and they sue me for manslaughter. We're enticing all these people from the southern borders to come up, and in the process of enticing them, they're being raped, trafficked, and we think that's humane? What does the scripture say about immigration? It's there. There's three titles for an immigrant that deals with it, where we can do it in a capacity that would bless human lives. But we never talk about that. We don't talk about it. And yet, society is waiting for these scriptures to be implemented in such a way that we can live together. And God laid it out for us. Liberty, like muscles, gets lost if you don't exercise it. Good government only happens with good people. We exercise the liberty God has entrusted to us. Liberty. Liberty. That's an interesting one. I always think of this idea of the law. The Bible says the law is a wise restraint that make men free. Not the Bible, but there's a quote in the stairwell at Harvard Law School. The wise restraints that make men free. You guys know Patrick Mahomes, right? My Mahomie. Amazing phenom. He's going to be playing in the Super Bowl. You don't get to the Super Bowl by being lazy. There's some practicing, lifting, working out. He's going to enjoy football at a level of excellence I'll never get a chance to enjoy. Why? The law is the wise restraints that make men free. Restraints. How do restraints make you free? You apply restraints towards evil in order to pursue excellence. You did your homework, didn't you, Adam? Now you have the future ahead of you, right? Lauren, you didn't. You're in trouble. We give everyone that opportunity to apply restraints. That's why we front load our kids. We don't allow liquor to be sold 100 yards from a school. We want to give them freedom to pursue excellence. Sin comes easy. I don't have to practice at it. Serious, I'm like, I have a PhD in sin. But to apply restraints in order to pursue excellence, that's why I'm a father. Husband of 30 years and a father of 5, 3 grandkids, pastor, mayor. When I was in high school, all my classmates go, "You're a what?" I was the least likely to be anything of those. I should be dead right now. Only God, and by saved by grace. Patrick Mahomes disciplined himself, applied restraint to enjoy football at a high level of excellence. This is what I'm going to be doing on Super Bowl Sunday. Right? There's no discipline in that, and that's why I can only sit and watch him enjoy it at an unbelievably high level of excellence. I am just lazy. I'm almost done. Where are we? That's a bad one, but the wise restraints that make men free. And then I'll close with this. Galatians 5, stand fast, serving with the liberty for which Christ has set you free. This is critical, and I'm going to leave you with this. We've been saved by grace through faith. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I get that. But in the same regard, God wants us to apply these laws, these godly laws, to point people to Christ. And if you don't do this in Texas, in 10 years, you're going to be like California. And if the church doesn't wake up and understand its role in the public square, we're in trouble. How will they know unless someone tells them? And if you think that we're supposed to cause the gospel to be truncated and myopic, you don't know the power of that gospel. And before you is an opportunity in a representative form of government to express yourself. Listen, you can vote yourself into socialism, but you can only shoot your way out. You want to protect freedoms? Exercise them. And if you can't do that, then don't decry the decline of the culture in which you live. You've been given a gift by God. designed in the Old Testament and given to the church so that we would honor a nation that has experienced more blessing than any other nation in the history of the world. The problems of America are universal to every other culture in the world. But the blessings of America are unique. Fight for them. God bless you guys.
Come on, let's stand up. You know, it's that kind of provocative, and that's what I'll say, provocative preaching and teaching that mobilizes us to be able to go out and change the world. I mean, you know what? I mean, if we just feed you bread and water, well, you'll survive till next week. But if we start giving some steak, then you'll feel energized and neutronized and, yeah, ready to go out and do something. And so, Rob, I appreciate you. Appreciate your boldness. Appreciate what you shared and imparted to us today. And we'll take that seed that you planted in us today, and we're going to let it grow. Amen. Lord, thank you for the day that we've had here this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. Lord, thank you for Rob, his wife, Michelle, their children, their grandchildren, their church, Lord. Protect them. Watch over them, Lord. Father, let the presence and the peace and the power of God just rest upon them. And, Lord, help us to receive this seed today. And let it take root in us, Lord, that we're not just some little gang, irrelevant group of people, Lord, that only show up here on Sunday, but we're the church of the living God. Like leaven, we go out into the highways and byways, Lord, and establish your kingdom in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. We're going to have an altar team at the front. If you have any need that you want to be prayed for or prayed over, then they'll be here to pray with you. So, team, come up. God bless you. Have a great, great afternoon. Thank you for being here this morning.